NEPM's podcasts are funded by Armbrook Village Senior Living in Westfield, with support services designed to help seniors age in place, including a Compass Memory Support Neighborhood. More at armbrookvillage.com. The Fabulous 413 podcast is funded by Northeast Solar, offering solar options, energy security, and solutions for the local community. Learn more at northeast-solar.com.
Welcome to the Fabulous 413. I'm Khalees Smith.
And I'm Monty Belmonte. It's Live Music Friday, and later in the show, we'll have live music from a small delegation of the rather large orchestra that the Valley birthed, the Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra. We have a quartet of them to play for us before their benefit concert tomorrow evening in Shelburne Falls.
And to have a little breather between our double shot of live music this Friday, we'll pop out to the Leverett Village Co-op where we'll try two California Cabernets to warm us up from that little nip of fall in the air.
And where we'll learn about how our Franklin County wine friend Ken Washburn is a ranked birder. I didn't know birding was a competition, but evidently there are rankings in bird watching.
Anything can be competitive if you want it to be. But first, we welcome to the studio the Hudson Valley-based singer-songwriter with strong ties to our valley, Dar Williams.
With 15 solo albums and 5 books under her belt, Dar Williams can now add benefit concert impresaria to her resume with the second annual, right? Second? Yep. Rivers and Roads Festival happening at Millside Park in Easthampton tomorrow and featuring the music of Dar Williams as well as Iris DeMent, Haley Hendricks, Sonny War, Gail Ann Dorsey, Paula Cole, Jill Sobule. The lineup is stellar.
Yeah, the lineup is fantastic. The festival is a partnership with the Connecticut River Conservancy, who coordinate the annual Source to Sea cleanup, one of the nation's largest river cleanups. There will be a cleanup event in Easthampton on Sunday, September 8th, the day after the festival. Thanks for coming, Dar Williams.
Thank you. Thank you.
Let's hear a song and then we'll chat.
All right, here we go.
Was a time I didn't like the love, I like the climbers. Was no sister then, was running out of time and one-liners. And I was afraid, like you are when you're too young to know the timing. So I watched the way you take a fear and hoard the horizon. You point, you have a word for every woman you can lay your eyes on, like you own them just because you bought the time. You turn to me, you say, I'm not threatened, whoa, 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 I'm not that petty. As cool as I am, I thought you know this already. I will not be afraid of women. I will not be afraid of women. So now we're at a club, you watch the woman dancing. She's drunk, she's smiling, and falling in that slow descending funk. The whole bar is loud and proud and everybody's trying out. You play the artist, saying is it how she moves or how she looks. I say it's loneliness suspended to our own like grappling hooks. And as long as she's got noise, she's fine. But I could teach her how I learned to dance when the music's ended. Whoa, 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 and that's not petty. As cool as I am, I thought you know this already. I will not be afraid of women. I will not be afraid of women. Try to make me doubt, to make me guess, try to make me feel like a little less so. I liked you when your soul was bared. I thought you knew how to be scared. And now it's amazing what you did to make me stay. But truth is just like time, it catches up and it just keeps going. Whoa, whoa, whoa. So I'm leaving. Find out how much better things can get. And if it helps, I say I feel a little worse than I did when we met. So when you find someone else, you can try again. Might work next time. You look out of the kitchen window and you shake your head and say low. If I could believe that stuff, I'd say that woman has a halo. And I look at it and say, yeah, she's really blonde. And then I go outside to join goes, whoa, 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 and that's not easy. Don't know what she saw, I want somebody who sees me. I will not be afraid of women. I will not be afraid of women.
Yay!
Woo! Dar Williams in the studio.
Full disclosure, my folk group in college, I brought that song to them and we did it. So somewhere on Kenyon campus is like footage of me performing that song with the Stairwells.
Right on. Thank you, Kenyon.
And isn't it like an official song for like Bryn Mawr College or something like
it's
that?
It's for their Mayhole Festival. Yeah, which is fantastic. But it's so good. Like my first love, the guy who totally broke my heart is a film professor at Kenyon. And I hope he heard it and he was like, wow.
Only I'd stayed.
I had no idea, but now I'm going to say something when I go back to reunion.
Exactly.
Music lovers in the Valley probably know, Dar, that you have a long history here in the Valley. I think it was the mid-90s, 93 or something, that you moved here. What brought you to the Northampton area?
Well, I first went to Boston because all my friends, I was a theater person, my friends all went to New York and they were broke and they were just suffering. And my friend said, come to Boston, do theater here. You can get a cappuccino and a bagel for less than $2. And I said, okay, that sounds all right. And it just really wasn't a theater town. They cast everything out of New York and or out of Harvard and music. You know, it was like everywhere. I went to a song swap in somebody's living room. That was sort of my introduction. I had a voice teacher who, you know, I said, I'm interested in opera or folk. And she said, well, can't help you with the opera, but go to the Naked City Coffee House and see what the open mic is like. And it just went on and on. And then I just felt like it was just everybody's mind was getting very busy and very, you know, who's on what rung of what ladder. And I was like, there's really no ladder. Like, really, yeah. There's not a lot of, it's a lot of tiny rungs on a tiny ladder. So I came out here to make sure that my mind was clear to write and to have this wonderful, I mean, it's really great. You got 91 and you've got 90.
Yeah.
And I tell people, like, that really counts for your, you know, on a fuel-efficient car.
Yeah.
So I had all this space, all this love, all this kindness, all this great stuff, and all the inspiration of the venues. And this is where everything just took off. I mean, I really came into who I was here.
I remember hearing your song. I worked at a radio station north of Boston, and I was in love with your song, Are You Out There? And then I was working at the radio station WRSI in Northampton, and for the first time ever, it clicked. Are You Out There? Can You Hear This? Jimmy Olsen, Johnny Memphis. Jimmy Olsen has been on this show a million times, Signature Sounds Records, architect of the Green River Festival, Johnny Memphis, a great DJ. And that's such an homage to radio that it's one of my favorite songs. It really touches me and shows you how important radio can be in people's lives.
100%.
And also typifies so much about the Valley and that time frame, I think.
Yeah, they had Homegrown Wednesdays. Yeah. And so you'd come in, and I came in. And I just loved Johnny Memphis because he was all like, everything was cool. Whatever came, whoever, whatever, he made it cool. Like, all right there, you know. you just smashed your guitar. All right, that's a choice, you know. And so I came in and then I did something for another radio station where I had a song that was one of their first songs on their fundraising CD. And they played that track on WRSI. So that's where I first heard myself on CD. Mm. And Johnny says, like, yeah, she's our hometown girl, but you know what? I think something's really happening here. Uh-huh. It was so, that encouragement meant the world to me.
Aww.
We're speaking with Dar Williams, who has strong ties to this valley and is coming back to the valley tomorrow to play in Easthampton for the second River Roads Festival.
So how did you connect with the Connecticut River Conservancy for this festival now in its second iteration?
Well, the first thing was that great park, the Millside Park, and then there was always, I love rivers. I think that I did a fundraiser recently where I said to this person for an inland bays conservancy in Delaware that I said, I want to be the protector of bogs and fens and swamps. And she goes, oh, who doesn't? And I was like, all right, all right. But I assumed that it was you know, because, I mean, a lot of people do things that are kind of like flashy, but I think rivers, as a metaphor, you know, lots of different kinds of people live along them. They flow in one direction. We're all trying to get there on there. And they reflect any good that you do on the land is reflected in the water. All of that stuff came together. And Connecticut River, I've always been in college or lived on the Connecticut River. And, of course, I'm on the Hudson now, which gets a lot of play because things rhyme with the Hudson, I guess. But the Connecticut is fantastic.
It's hard to rhyme Connecticut.
Well, it's too many syllables. It takes up too much of your line before you have to get to something else.
Exactly.
Also, everyone cool I know wants to be a bog witch when they grow up. So, like, you know.
Right. Okay. So I didn't understand that there was a real cult of the bog witches. Yeah. And so that was like me trying to get into a really crowded, cool room. But I'll try to be a bit of a river princess. And I love protecting. It's so important because the land, you have to be protecting both the land and the water in order to protect the most important food chain species that are both. They're called amphibians, but, you know, and river birds. So that's a beautiful metaphor, too, that we have to be looking out for the whole picture, not just one thing or another.
And there is a river cleanup in conjunction with this River Roads Festival happening on Sunday in Easthampton. I think the actual source to see cleanup is a little bit later in the month on the 28th, and we'll probably have some folks from the Connecticut River Conservancy on to talk about that. But it's a great – I've participated in that cleanup so many different times, and it's a great way to really experience the river to see what damage we as humans are doing to it, but also to feel like you're helping at least a little bit.
They told us that we had a lot of people last year, and I was there. I fell asleep. I was
during the cleanup?
Well, because people just brought the trash to my feet and they were probably like, yeah, she showed up, but but I'll be much more awake this year. And I love it. You know, it really takes doing one of these things to understand that you actually do. You do feel like you're a part of something when you do it. And we collect a lot of stuff.
We're speaking with Dar Williams, whose second annual River Roads Festival is happening at Millside Park in Easthampton tomorrow, Saturday, September 7th. Do you pick the lineup? I mean, we mentioned how much we appreciate the lineup. How does that come together? Are you just asking your dynamic, incredible performer friends?
Kind of. So we do call in some favors.
Yeah.
Or some people do say, well, I know Dar, and Dar wouldn't screw me over, so you know that. But... it's Laudable Productions. They're great.
Yep.
I have a wonderful booking agent. And then Patty Romanoff is probably more famous than I am. She's my manager and lives here in the Valley.
She sure does.
And she's just really great at putting out the word to let people know that they can trust us. I mean, a lot of it is just making sure people know it's not just fun, but it's cool.
Yeah.
And we're like, these people in the Northampton audiences are the ones that have been so deeply there for the music at festivals and concerts. Like, they invest in the things that they see. It's always a good, it's a crowd that stays with you.
Yeah, are we better than your other valley, the Hudson Valley here?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, I knew it! We're number one.
Well, no, you know, I love you both in different ways.
That's fine. You don't have to pick between your children. Yeah. It's fine.
Exactly. But I'll say there's something really unique about sort of New England, this river valley, in terms of pushing. You know, I have an electric car, and you go to the food co-op, and there's like 20 chargers, and they're all full. You know, that's not where the rest of the pushing of the needle in terms of like. Where the future is going is here. You know, it doesn't look that way. It's cows and tobacco barns, but it's here. Mm-hmm. And so I always love to see what's coming next because it's here. So that's great.
Well, let's hear something else from Dar Williams, whose festival is happening in Easthampton tomorrow.
Okay, so since we don't have a lot of time, I'm just going to stay in this tuning. I won't do my dad gad, and this is the song. But
tuning joke.
Oh, sorry.
I have to bring whole other guitars when I use that tuning. It's like, no one's got time for this.
Well, you know, I just feel like 100% of the people who are listening know what dad gad tuning is. Like, that's a thing.
They do now.
Okay, so this is this is called End of the Summer, and I wrote it when I was living in Hadley, and I would go running around all of the farmland and farm stands and just really feeling that turn of the season. It is unbelievable here.
Yeah.
The summer ends. friends, and we wonder where we are. And there you go, my friends, with your boxes in your car. And you both look so young, and last night was hard, she said. You packed up every room, and then you cried and went to bed. But today you closed the door and said, we have to get a move on. It's just that time of year when we push ourselves ahead. We push ourselves ahead. It was cloudy in the morning, and it rained as you drove away. The same things look different. It's the end of the summer. It's the end of the summer when you move to another place. And I feel like the neighbor's girl who will never be the same. She walked alone all spring. She had a boyfriend when the summer came. And he gave her flowers in a lightning storm. They disappeared at night in green fields of silver corn. And sometime in July, she just forgot that he was leaving. So when the fields were dying, she held on to his sleeves. She held on to his sleeves. And she doesn't want to let go, 'cause she won't know what she's up against. Classrooms and the smart girls, it's the end of summer. It's the end of summer when you hang your flowers up to dry. And I had a dream, it blows the autumn through my head. It felt like the first day of school, but I was going to the moon instead. And I walked down the hall with the notebooks they got for me. My dad led me through the house. My mom drank instant coffee. And I knew that I would crash, but I didn't want to tell them. There are just some moments when your family makes sense, when it just makes sense. So I raised up my arms, and my mother put the sweater on. We walked out on the dark and frozen grass. The end of summer, it's the end of the summer when you send your children to the moon. The summer ends, and we wonder where we are. And there you go, my friends, with your boxes in your car. Today I pass the high school, the river, the maple tree. I pass the farms that made it through the last days of the century. And I knew that I was gonna learn again, again in this less hazy light. I saw the fields beyond the fields, the fields beyond the fields. And the colors are much brighter now. It's like they really want to tell the truth. Raise it to the dark and frozen grass. The end of summer, it's the end of the summer. You can spin the light to gold.
Yay!
Dar Williams. So bittersweet.
I was feeling it. I was feeling it.
I know.
It's hard to say goodbye to summer, but one good way to, we still have 3 weeks.
Yep.
Absolutely.
To be fair.
Take advantage of every one of them.
Yes. Mm. And there's still lots of outdoor fun stuff to do, including the River Roads Festival happening at Millside Park tomorrow, September 7th, with a stellar lineup, as we mentioned, including Dar Williams, who put this festival on for the second year in a row. Thank you so much for coming in and playing for us today.
Thank you both.
Oh, it's a joy.
Coming up later in the show, more live music with the Happy Valley Guitar Quartet, a delegation from the larger Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra.
But up next, California Cabernet and Franklin County Birdwatching. We'll take the Wine Thunderdome to the Leverett Village Co-op and talk with Level 2 sommelier and birdwatcher Ken Washburn.
You're listening to The Fabulous 413 on 88.5 NEPM.
NEPM's podcasts are funded by Armbrook Village Senior Living in Westfield, with support services designed to help seniors age in place, including a Compass Memory Support Neighborhood. More at armbrookvillage.com.
this is why I chose sort of heftier wines this time, is because, you know, it's September, we're all wearing sweatshirts, you know, it's time.
It's time to wine Thunderdome once again with our Franklin County wine friend Ken Washburn here at the lovely Leverett Village Co-op, the only store in Leverett, Massachusetts.
That's right, and you say that every time.
Because it's true. It's important to let people know that there's a store here. You live in Leverett. There's this store. It's this one.
And that if you wanted to continue, you should shop at this store a lot.
Also, you don't have to live in Leverett to shop here.
Yeah.
Like many other stores.
Yeah.
And it's a co-op, which is fun.
Yes, it is a co-op.
Yeah. And Ken, if you don't recall, is a level 2 sommelier, so you are the most advanced wine snob, I believe, that we drink with on a regular basis.
Oh, wow. Damn. Well, I feel like I'm about to undo all of that, because the wines that we're tasting today are a category that I know so pathetically little about. California cabs.
Is it because most of them in the affordable range tend to be garbage?
Not a big fan of affordable California cabs, by and large, because a lot of times they're gross.
Yeah. Tend to agree. I don't think that either of these are gross, but what I think is funny is, why haven't we done California cabs yet? Well, it's because I didn't really have any. There have been multiple times where I've been standing in front of the wine selection and I'm like, what's missing? And I'm like, nothing. It's perfect. And then I have customers come in being like, do you have any Cabernets? Do you have anything big and juicy? And I look at my section and I'm like, no, not really. So I reached out to one of my reps and I was like, hey, I need help. In fact, I had so few American wines in general. Lots of Italy, lots of France, some Spain, but we were suffering over here for America. I mean, American wines they're expensive.
Unless they're the cheapest thing in the world.
Yeah.
Yes. To their credit, they are getting better.
But California, still affordable in some ways, but not always great while affordable. But let's try these ones. We're going to try California
Cab. I think we've really set these up to maybe not be great.
One of them's got a much lower alcohol content than I would expect from a California. This one's at 13.
Yeah, that was the one that I was going to go for first.
Okay.
Two wines today. Number one, we've got the Noah River Cabernet Sauvignon. It just says California on the label, but I did a little digging, and it's from Lodi. So Lodi is actually, it's Central Valley, it's just north of Stockton, which I think is where the band Pavement is from. That wine is the one that Khalees pointed out, 13% alcohol, so pretty low for that.
And it's called, once again, what?
Noah River, 2021.
Carve your path, be boundless.
Is that what it says on the back?
That's what it says on the back.
Inspiration.
Yeah, and then the second wine is called One Stone Cabernet Sauvignon, and this one's from Paso Robles. So we don't have any, we're not doing any Napa or Sonoma today. Paso Robles is known for Rhone blends, and it's Central Coast near San Luis Obispo, which I learned is often called the happiest city in the United States.
San Luis Obispo?
Yeah.
It's a fun name.
Most of what I know about that town, I remember from boarding school where we had a handful of kids from there. And what I remember most is opioid use.
Oh. That doesn't usually lead to a happy town.
They have an alley that's covered in discarded bubble gum, and that's my memory of the place. So sounds very happy so far.
Well, let's try the Noah River one. Cabernet.
It's Noah time.
Ooh. Cali Cab, as you
will. Cali Cab. I couldn't find anything about the grape makeup of this wine. As we know, I believe any wine that claims to be single varietal in the U.S., it only has to be 70% that varietal. I'm just going to assume that it's cab with maybe a little else in it.
We round up.
We have rounded up. So
it's remarkably light in color for a California cab. I would be tricked to look at it to think that this might be a California Pinot Noir. It's a little darker than most French Pinot Noir.
It does look like a Pinot, yeah.
It's light in color.
Almost like a very slightly garnet rim for the nerds that like to look at the color.
Yeah. It's a little hot on the nose. It's a little hotter than
it
I was expecting.
Smells like it's going to be boozy.
It's interesting because I actually opened it earlier. Normally I open it while y'all are here. But I just wanted to let this one breathe a little bit before y'all got here.
And a little like brandy-y on top of the hot, like
brown
spirit.
Smells like mulled wine almost.
Yeah.
You know, you've got the spices, but then you've got that little extra alcohol to it, like if you poured a little bit of rum in there or something like that.
Yeah. I'm definitely getting like the cinnamons and all those other holiday mulled spicy things going.
Also like the dried fruit you put in it too. Like this is pruney.
I'm also getting a good amount of chocolate on the palate.
This one, it did spend a year in 20% new French oak. So that's what's responsible for those spice notes for sure. And for those that don't know, oak is responsible for things being vanilla-y, buttery, chocolatey, caramelly, spicy, etc.
And French oak has a tighter grain, so it imparts less of the oak flavors into the wines than an American oak, which has a wider grain and often imparts more of those things.
I genuinely thought you were going to say, like, oak is known to be overused in California wine.
That is also true.
If you say California wines to a lot of people, they're going to think about super fruity, not super acidic, which is also known as flabby, and really oaky.
This is nice. I don't mean to disparage it in this way, but I would believe that it's not a California wine.
It is a lot softer and smaller than I was expecting.
It's so soft. It's very, the tannins are really gentle.
Yeah.
I get a little bit of vanilla now on the palate, actually.
Can't hide what you are.
You are California, aren't you?
Next on The Californians.
Get all the 405 and so you can't take it anymore.
Like to Ventura?
I'm getting that good hair of the dog that bit you feeling where, like, you were out until 2 o'clock in the morning playing an interactive version of John Carpenter's The Thing.
Anyone messes with me and the whole camp goes.
Is that what you were doing?
Yeah.
Like, or like you were DJing a yacht rock party until midnight. And then got home, went to bed, and somehow found yourself awake at 4:30 in the morning like your great-grandma.
Or you were looking at the photos from your 4-hour birding excursion to Westport.
Yeah.
What was that like? What did you find?
I walked 7 miles yesterday looking for one specific bird.
Did you find it?
I did, but I didn't think that I did until I looked at my photos when I got home.
What was the bird?
It's called a ruddy turnstone, and you should really Google what it looks like because they're absolutely adorable. They're like if you mixed a sandpiper with a calico cat.
Ken Washburn, tell us about this thing that I just found out about from you, that there are rankings of birders, and that there is a Franklin County ranking, and that you are getting into the upper echelons of the Franklin County rankings of birders.
Embarrassing. I would not consider myself upper echelons. I've just been doing a lot of birding this year, basically all my free time, birding. There's something called eBird. It's run by the Cornell Lab of Ornithology. They're also responsible for the app Merlin, which is like Shazam for birds.
Love
I think
app.
I've talked about this. I don't know how I always manage to talk about. I've talked about birds on this show before because we can hear them. We're sitting outside. It's a beautiful place to sit and drink wine. eBird, you have an account and you submit your observations. So we could do an eBird report for our little wine tasting session. I've seen a cat bird and some stuff like that. You submit how many individuals of certain species you've seen. Sometimes if it's a very rare bird, a moderator will send you an email and be like, did you really see that? And you have to prove it, either with a very detailed description, audio, or a photo. And then it gets added. It gets added to your life list, or it gets added to how many birds you've seen in a certain county, in a certain month, in a certain year. And you can just kind of climb the ranks by doing a lot of birding and adding a lot of submissions.
What are you ranked right now, Ken?
Oh, gosh. Okay, I'll pull it up. My August ranking was good, but it's September now, and it's so nice outside. My eBird. Top 100, compare with the top e-birders in your region. 2024, Franklin. And this, you can do this for all over the world. Yesterday I was birding in Bristol County, so my submission would count for Bristol. I'm number 14. As of this year, I've seen 111 birds in Franklin County in 2024. 14. Good job, me.
Yeah!
Yeah!
What's the coolest bird you've seen this year?
Oh, God. People ask that question pretty frequently. I really wanted to see a Blackburnian warbler. Again, very visually striking, so you should look it up. And I saw one at Fitzgerald Lake in Northampton.
Khaleesi and I saw a scarlet tanager.
They're gorgeous.
They're great.
That's the coolest bird I've seen this year, I think.
Yes. It was going after some blueberries.
All right. What's wine number two here in the Franklin County Birding Wine Thunderdome at the Leverett Village Co-op with number 14 in Franklin County, Ken Washburn, level 2 sommelier.
You can come to Leverett Village Co-op and bird while you drink.
I feel like I'm really such a novice birder. I've only been doing it like super, super, super seriously for about a year at this point.
But it's cool that people can now, if they are amateur birders, they can sign up for this thing and they can collaborate with other people.
It's awesome because it's basically a gigantic citizen science project. So if there's a certain bird you're looking for, you can find out who's seen it, where they've seen it most recently, what time, etc. And that's what led me to Westport, Massachusetts, where I'd never been before yesterday. So anyway, one stone Cabernet Sauvignon from Paso Robles. It says Cabernet Sauvignon on the bottle. Doesn't say anything about any other grapes. Again, classic USA. We've got pretty lax rules here compared to places like France. 79% Cab, 11% Malbec, 5% Merlot, 5% Syrah. This was aged a little bit over a year in French and American oak. So it was just French oak on the last. We've got a mix on this one here. Cabernet.
On the back, it says that this vineyard fosters young women winemakers. I hope that that's true.
Very cool.
I hope that they expand to non-binary winemakers sometime in the future and on their labels.
This one has a very similar nose with the dried fruit and a lot of the chocolatey stuff.
Yeah, but definitely more of the chocolate, more chocolate, more dirt.
I'm definitely getting the more dirt.
The color is definitely more of sort of that inky purple, definitely a cooler tone in the glass, more what you would expect from a Cabernet.
Yeah.
Something I thought would be fun is that I looked at the tasting notes on the website and I wanted to see, do we perceive these tasting notes? Mm-hmm. For this, it says plum and then it says black olive.
Hmm.
So, are we getting black olive?
I can see that, but to me there's something else above that.
Can you smell it?
No.
No.
I learned pretty quickly in the wine industry that the tasting notes on websites, it's just rampant plagiarism from wine reviewers. I used to have access to Robert Parker's wine reviewing website, E. Robert Parker, and then I would go on to different websites, looking at tasting notes, etc., and it would just be copied and pasted from reviewers. It's interesting because, you know, when I was in wine school, we would all be tasting a wine and we'd say to the master sommeliers, does this taste like strawberry? And they'd be like, yes, it does. And then other times we'd be like, does this taste like orange peel? And they'd be like, no. It's subjective, but also not at the same time.
Yeah, my wine mother did the same thing. She's like, there's nothing wrong that you smell or taste in any wine. And then I'd be like, it tastes like chocolate. Wrong. I do this to my children all the time now. It's whatever you smell or taste in this wine.
Mm.
Oh, is it this? Nope. I thought you said it was whatever. No, you're wrong.
Isn't it black olive? Nah.
If I stretch, I can kind of get a Kalamata-y thing, but it's a stretch. This is way more grippy than the last one. This is...
More tannin.
Yes.
But I think more Kalamata olive than black olive.
Yeah, for sure.
Honestly, I hate olives.
Oh, well.
Whoa.
When I worked at the Spanish table, the Spanish import store in Berkeley, my coworkers were horrified to hear that I'd never willingly eaten an olive. And they basically strapped me down and were like, here's the best kind. I think it was maybe a Manzanilla olive. We had them stuffed with anchovy. We had them stuffed with lemon.
You are speaking my language.
And it was just okay.
Oh, my word. In Spain, that was the best thing. My wife also hates olives, and I was like, I'm going to eat every olive.
This is how I feel about my partner. My partner also doesn't like that. I'm just like, awesome. These are all for me now.
Yeah.
Tasting notes for this one say brambly, and I do agree with that. It's twiggy.
Yeah.
Just a bunch of snap twigs, which I actually love in a wine. Fell face first into a bush.
Hello.
I need you to use Pizzicato 5's Twiggy Twiggy.
This is a lot more what I would expect from a California Cabernet. And I like it, actually. I think it's a nice wine. The first one, the Noah River, I think that was the first California cab that we'd had in a while. And it's, of course, I buy this cab that's, like, completely atypical. I'm like, fine, I'll get a Cali cab. And then it's just, like, not a Cali cab at all. And this one is. This is nice.
This is very much a Cali cab. I'm trying not to sound so disappointed when I say that.
I'm not disappointed in this at all. It might not be my preferred first go-to, but there are times, like, if I'm looking for something affordable, and I know that I've already had this one, let's say, and it's affordable, and I know I'm going to, like, throw burgers on the grill or some steaks or something like that, perfect.
Honestly, I just love wine, you know? Yeah, I would not go out of my way to have Cali Cab. Actually, my partner's family, they love Cab, and I've had a lot of Cab at their house, and it kind of brought me back into the fold, you know? Because I think it's easy as wine lovers to get into these habits. But something that I like about this segment and that y'all have been here now so many times is that I'm like, you know, I could bring out the funky stuff every time, but it's like, I feel like I want to do something different, and this feels very different from what we would do together.
Yeah. Not being so esoteric is different in this case.
Let's be normies for a moment.
Good luck to us.
Yeah, I think we're a freaky little group here.
Anybody ready to vote?
I'm nervous. I don't know why. No stakes whatsoever. But I feel like we're usually in agreement, and this time I'm not so sure.
I know which one Monty's going to pick, and I'm pretty sure I'm going to pick the other one.
I'm picking the One Stone.
Yeah.
It is more reserved. It's less sweet. It's got really good tannins. And while there are no stakes here, if there were a steak here, this would go perfect with it.
I'm also picking the One Stone. I think that it has a better structure. The Noah River was really nice up front, and then it kind of just dissipated. So, One Stone it is.
Yeah, so One Stone wins.
But you vote for the other one.
I vote for the other one. I don't like when wines bully my tongue. It's part of the reason why I don't, in general, like California Cabernets. They're too big. They don't allow anything else to come in and do anything. And in general, I liked the Noah River. I don't think I got a clean second taste of it because of what was happening with the One Stone, some of which is the stuff that I shy away from.
Kenneth, Leverett Village Co-op, anything fun happening here?
Yes, actually, we're having our annual Harvest Festival. It's October 6th from noon to 4. We've got a bunch of fun stuff planned. We're going to have a palm reader, horse and carriage rides, big family-friendly stuff. Not so family-friendly is that I'm going to be doing a cider tasting. Yeah, I know. You should definitely come to that. We're going to have food, pumpkin painting, and we've got such a great outdoor space. So just come. We're going to celebrate the season here.
And if people are birders and want to be part of this Franklin County ranking system that you're number 14 in, Ken, what's that website again?
It's eBird. eBird.org.
Yeah.
Nice.
Cornell Lab eBird.
I wonder if you can rank movies on that website.
On the eBird website?
Yeah, Siskel and eBird.
Time to go.
Next, how many guitarists does it take to raise funds for an orchestra?
In this case, 4 guitarists from the Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra, who usually have to play in big spaces, but they'll play in a small bookstore in Shelburne Falls tomorrow, and they'll play our small studio next as Double Live Music Friday continues.
You're listening to The Fabulous 413 on 88.5 NEPM.
NEPM's podcasts are funded by Armbrook Village Senior Living in Westfield, offering assisted living and compass memory support with evidence-based treatment for those with memory loss. More at armbrookvillage.com. The Fabulous 413 podcast is funded by the UMass 5 College Credit Union, offering co-op advantage checking with cash back on all purchases, plus secure debit card controls, all from the UMass 5 mobile banking app. Insured by NCUA, umass5.coop.
Welcome back to the Fabulous 413. I'm Monty Belmonte.
And I'm Khalee Smith. The Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra presents A Night of Guitar Music, a special fundraising concert tomorrow, Saturday, September 7th at 7 p.m. at Raven Used Books in Shelburne Falls.
This concert will be a bit different than their usual concerts in that it will not be the entire orchestra. Instead, some orchestra members have spent the summer working on music in small ensembles, which allows them to play in small venues like Raven or this studio.
This event will feature a repertoire of songs that spans genres from Bach to modern composers to contemporary favorites. The funds raised will support the orchestra's operating expenses and help offset the cost of the 2024-25 season, as the Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra is a 501c3 nonprofit.
We are joined in the studio by the Happy Valley Guitar Quartet. Do you have a band name when you do this? Or you just...
We don't have a band name.
I like Happy Valley Guitar Quartet because there are 4 of you, and it's orchestra sounding to call yourself a quartet.
The Happy Valley Guitar-like light orchestra.
Light. I like that too, yeah. 2 of you have Violent Femmes shirts on as well, so maybe that it feels like the Violent Femmes are in the studio in some ways. But we are joined by the orchestra members Emmett Troxel, Charlie Salzberg, Dave Freed, and Amy Lashley. Sorry about that, Amy. Amy Lashley. Let's start with a song before we chat about your history of the guitar and the guitar orchestra.
Thank you.
The Happy Valley Light Orchestra, the Happy Valley Guitar Quartet with Emmett Troxel taking the lead on that one on the Taylor guitar, with Amy Lashley playing a classical acoustic, with Charlie Salzberg playing the bass over there, and Dave Freed playing a Fender Strat.
So all of the sections of the Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra are represented.
Yeah, is that, are we missing a section or is that it?
Drums.
Oh yeah, drums, yeah.
That doesn't
count. We won't count it for the moment.
Who comes to the guitar orchestra and counts the drums?
About how many current members are the full orchestra are there right now? Do we know?
Twins?
About 20.
Somebody in front of those mics speak right into that as a representative.
15 to 20.
15 to 20. Okay, so we got like a decent chunk of the orchestra here.
Has it been hard to shrink your sound down to something smaller? Has it felt different, like rehearsing these songs for this fundraiser?
Yeah. So I think it's been really interesting. We had to rearrange some existing songs for just four pieces, and so we have to really choose what we do and really listen to dynamics. You also can't rely on someone else to cover your part. If you flub up, you actually have to know your part. So there's that.
Are there other smaller ensembles that have grown out of the orchestra, or are you the only current one?
No, there are four groups playing tomorrow.
Oh, cool.
So there's us, there's another quartet, there's a duo, and then there's a slightly larger group playing only Bach pieces.
Oh. So. Oh, the finger workouts.
Yeah. these guys are in that group.
Yeah. Yes, I remember.
The Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra, currently led by the artistic director Joseph Ricker, but worth noting that the founder is Peter Blanchett, who will be our musical guest next Live Music Friday next week, and has created a guitar called the Arch Guitar, basically so he could play Bach on the guitar, and now is making all of you folks play Bach, as well as other popular contemporary things, and Philip Glass, and lots of... one of our theme songs is your orchestra doing Wilco's One Wing, which is fun, because we had Wilco member on the show last week. Maybe we should take a little break.
Let's take a quick break, and
then we'll come back and hear another song and chat some more. We're talking with the Happy Valley Guitar Quartet on Live Music Friday.
You're listening to The Fabulous 413 on 88.5 NEPM.
Welcome back to the Fabulous 413. We are joined in the studio by four members of the Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra: Emmett Troxel, Charlie Salzberg, Dave Freed, and Amy Lashley, who will be performing tomorrow in Shelburne Falls at the New Raven Used Bookstore there, because now this giant guitar orchestra from the Valley has broken up into disparate parts, only to reassemble again as Voltron at another time, but where they can play smaller venues like a bookstore or this studio. It's a fundraiser for the nonprofit orchestra that has non-professional mostly, people that just love guitar getting together to play, which is so cool. What was the first song we heard, Amy?
The first song was a piece by a French composer named Roland Dienz. It's called Lettre à la Seine, Letter to the Seine River. It needs some love. This is our love to it. But yeah, he's a really cool composer, mostly classical, but he has like a jazz bent on like almost everything he does. So I think that comes through. And we're playing two pieces by him tomorrow.
And what's the next one we're going to hear right now? Emmett?
So the next one is by Japanese composer Koji Kondo, who is most famously known for writing all of the video game music for the Super Mario Brothers and Legend of Zelda. Woo-hoo. So we're playing a piece from the classic 1998 game Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time.
Yes.
It's called Gerudo Valley, which is set in a like vaguely Middle Eastern area. So of course you think, when you think vaguely Middle Eastern, you think Latin, of course.
Yeah.
So that's what we'll be playing today.
All right.
It's like, I know this piece.
Yes. Is four members of the Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra performing that song from Legend of Zelda.
And then
Ocarina
there's variations on it on every sequential Legend of Zelda ever.
Yeah, so if that sounds familiar to you, it's great that this video game music is getting this kind of treatment, not only from your orchestra, but other orchestras, because I think a lot of people were exposed to orchestral music from Bugs Bunny, but now more and more people are being exposed to orchestral music where video games are the link, if you'll pardon the Legend of Zelda pun. Oh,
walked right into
it. Yes, you did. We only have a minute or so left, but how long has everybody been in the orchestra?
So I've been in the orchestra, since its inception in 2009. So I'm the rookie.
Amy?
2021. I'm the newbie.
Uh-huh.
I'm a little bit less of a newbie. I joined in 2019, and then our season was cut short because of COVID.
Yeah, that was Emmett. Charlie on bass?
2018.
So, yeah, about 6 years or so.
That's awesome. There's such a good span of pieces and, like, time that people have been in there. I've known people that have come in and out over the years, too. It's such a great, interesting organization and organization of music.
Have you all learned how to read music because of this, or did you go into it reading music? Amy shakes it off. Dave says,
"My sight reading was horrific, and now it's just bad."
Okay, Emma.
No, I read sheet music before this, but not for the guitar. It's a whole different thing when you're doing guitar.
Yeah, yes. Charlie.
This is actually my first experience doing any kind of music. So,
wow.
So, yeah, I'm kind of learning how to read, I would say.
We just picked Charlie up off the street.
I wonder if Charlie's telling us the full truth. He was joking about not wanting to share his story back there and knowing that we wouldn't be able to fact check him in real time. We're just going to put a pin in that one, Charlie, and say, I don't know. You're a pretty good bass player.
Also, don't throw out there the idea that you can just go out there on the street and pick up a bass player from anywhere.
Yeah.
Well, this is the Valley. So if there's any place that you can do that,
I'm sure you can. The yeah, they're probably hitchhiking. Well, they're playing tomorrow, Saturday, September 7th, 7 p.m. at Raven Used Books in Shelburne Falls. Not just this quartet, but other parts of the Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra. And it's a benefit for this wonderful community orchestra where people can come together and play guitar together and do these big and little performances now. Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra in Shelburne tomorrow. Thank you all so much.
Thank you for having us.
We'll go for it.
Next week on the Fabulous 413, we get to name a moon.
Not quite, but we'll talk with a couple of folks who did get to name a quasi-moon and let you know how you might be able to name one as well with Latif Nasser of Radiolab and Kelly Blumenthal of the International Astronomical Union.
And we'll get into the nitty-gritty of climate change on micro and macro scales when we hear about the upcoming local climate summit.
And we'll welcome to the studio Peter Blanchett, who founded the Happy Valley Guitar Orchestra, as well as Ellis Kennedy, who will be performing next week. I'm Monty Belmonte.
I'm Khalee Smith. We'll see you next week on the Fabulous 413.